frames like we have to make. What we will do is we put enough frames out here. Just remove enough frames out of here. Have room to shake the bees down in there. Pop this cap off. Take the fan off, and there's usually a piece of wood on top of here. Pop this cap out. And get the queen. Try not to lose her down in here, like we do, like Mary and I do. But she'll be in here. You have to take the fork out because there's candy in there. And the bees will eat into it here, and they'll be eating out, and she'll come out there. Put this queen cage between a couple of these frames. Like so. Fall down in there. There. Anyway, you put it down in there, and then the best thing to do is put it in the middle. And if you open this and take this can out, start putting these, you're going to shake the bees right on the top of her. And shake the bees down in the bottom of the, down in the bottom of the hive. And then what we do is set this box, because we still bees in here. We need to set this down in front of the hive, because they're going to come to this plant. So if there's any stragglers still down in here, they will come into the hive by these plants. Because they'll come to the queen. Remember, they always like to come to their queen. Then once you get it all in here, put the frames back on. Put your inner cover on and your cover on. Like I said, if you have any stragglers or any other ones still outside, they'll come to the plant. She's inside, so that's their plant. If they know that, they know that our pheromones are there. If you're working with a mentor will show you or come and help you install your leaves.
When the cork thing that they eat and the gnat comes out, does she come out there, or do we have to get her out of the...
No, she will come out with that. She will. There's candy in there. There's a cork in there. Pop the cork out. And then the bees are eating from this side, and they're eating from this side, and she gives you the escape that way.
Okay, so you just leave the cave, the bee cage in there.
Yeah, but then a couple of days, she needs to go back in there and make sure she got out. So she needs to go out, and she's going to die in that cave. She comes with three or four bees in the cage with her that are feeding her. After the installation, feed the bees heavily until the colony is well established. Sugar water mix, one. Not sugar, one. That's for spring feeding. That's what we're going to be installing bees. Usually we don't put bees in. Off. Keep the entrances reduced to a small size until the colony is well established. Reason being, if you're feeding the bees, they aren't established, they're not looking yet, the robber bees will come in there and eat all the food. They like the sugar water. Do not add supers or a second hive body until the bees have drawn out and covered seven of the frames. So, once you install the bees in here, let them start filling bees before you add another super. Because if you add another super, there aren't enough bees in here to take care of it. First thing you're going to have is wax moths. Because you've got to have enough bees to protect the hive. If they're all down in here working, this box on top is not doing any good. It's just empty space for something to take over. Don't add another seven super until they've covered seven or of the frames. Okay. disturbing the bees, and yeah, they're going to get mad. It's just like if somebody walked into your house, you want to mad, you get mad. This is also what you're looking for when you go in there. You're looking for eggs. You're looking for cat breed. You're looking to see if the hive is healthy. You think these bees are about to swarm? I'd say not. I'd say they're just trying to keep the hive cool. That's what they do in the summertime. They call that bearding. Sometimes I'll see them on the side of my hive, and they'll be almost touching the ground. Because they're at the entrance trying to keep the hive cool. In the summertime, when it's real hot, they hang out inside the hive, in the hive at least. I just wanted to show you this again because this is excessive drone sales. Is there something else you're looking for when you go into the hive? Here, these are all queen cells. That one there on top is queen cell one. This one's on the bottom of the frame. These are right in the middle of the frame. But I would say, again, if they're building queen cells like this, then they're competition small. When a hive gets full, they make a good queen and half a full queen for all of them. And keep your bees healthy. Don't sling burp home on the ground. You say, what's burp home? These seal off everything. They don't want any holes or any waves or anything. I'll go in the hive and they'll be combed right there on top of the frame. Scrape that off. Don't throw it on the ground. Take your bucket with you whenever you go into your bee yard to put all that burp on the ground. Had a lady at our meeting last month that was telling us what to do with wax. She takes all her burp home and puts it in the bucket and takes it in and melts it and makes candles out of it. So it's good for something, but don't swing it into your bee yard. If you have a bee yard here and one over here in Smithville, you should at least wash it. Clean your hive tool between your yards, because if this one has a disease, you don't want to take it to this one over here. Like last year, we went to Joe's house and bought a pit bed, and I asked everybody, please don't bring your hive tool. Joe doesn't want your germs from your bees in his hives, so don't take your hive tool from this yard to this yard. Wear clean gloves, wash them off. Now, I know they're calf skin or some different skin types you can get, but I just don't like washing them. I have to watch it whenever after I wash it because they're getting pretty tight. So I've learned that after I wash them, before I put them out to dry, and I don't dry them, I'll put my hand in it and make sure all the fingers are popped out again because it's kind of dirty in the morning. Anytime you're in the bees, look for diseases. Be careful not to use diseased equipment on bees. Gifts can cost you bees. Like he said a while ago, if grandma and grandpa had bees 100 years ago, and they got all those hives sitting in the barn, and they said, well, you can have all the time. You don't want all the time. Because it can cost you all your everything. The hives get diseases in the framework, you reuse it, you can get diseases in all the rest of the hives. John, did you have something you want to say?
Well, I was just thinking about, you know, there's a couple of things that bees get. There's only two diseases that they'll make you just burn your hives and just can't get over it. It's got foul burning. You know, the only source you got is the state expert says burning. Now, he tells us the state inspectors, go out there and find that, you call him. Because he'll make it, but he don't want us to shop. I appreciate that. But, you know, that's a terrible thing to tell somebody that they should pay their house tax out. And it is, like I said, if you can share a lot of tools, things like that, so you want to do that. Have you noticed? Well, there's a lot of ways to do, but I mean, you know, there's actually, you've heard us saying, there's an app for that. I've got an app on my phone to show you every disease that bees have, one of them. Bowel root's one, show you the characteristics, chalk root, there's other kinds of diseases, if you look through that, you can see, you'll see in the books, I've got pictures of that. You can smell an odor, you can open the top of a bee box, and you're working, and they can slime by hives, they'll be the biggest glue and mess in them, and a lot of maggots, looks like the size of a baseball. That's pretty obvious what that is. But other diseases, things like that, you have to know, there's a smell about it. You learn after you catch bees, well, that doesn't smell right. So it's important to use all your senses when you're digging in there. You start looking at the root patterns and show you there, and they're flat and black, and you stick two digits. There's lots of ways to tell, but you'll get more into that. It's a lot to absorb.
Can you give us the name of the app that you actually want to use?
I'll give it to you if you ask. I'll put it on the phone. It was free. I don't know what it is now. It's a great app. As a matter of fact, you've got the same thing in the book, so.
There are several predators that can affect your bees, but don't let that scare you off. Let's start with the law.
Take on the law.
The row mites are small, dark brown, blood-sucking mites. They live on the adult and larval stages of the honeybees. They are known to vector diseases to bees by feeding on them. They might feed some dogs. There's test kits that you can get to test for them. Some ways to treat them is with oxalic acid, right away, aspartame strips, etc. Find all of those in the books or online. You will have to repoint your family colonies and keep your colony strong to control your all-night population.
On the back table there, I've got oxalic acid.
Back home, very distinct. They'll lay
grows to be about inch long. There'll be hundreds of them in there if they ever get in.
Wax moths are very destructive pests to the colony. The male and female will fly into the colony 1 to 3 hours after dark and lay masses of light-colored eggs. The larva will eat away at the comb and create webbing between the frames. A strong comb to the bees to defend itself against the wax moth. But it has to be a strong colony. We've lost a hive of wax moths. And wax are a little cleaned up, I suppose. To me, it wasn't worth cleaning up. Then you have the almighty hive bee. Hive bees are strong, uniform, dark brown to black beetles about 5 to 7 millimeters long. The larva will feed on the honey and the pollen. If the infestation is severe enough, the beetles will abandon the hive. Beetles hide in cracks and crevices of the hive. And they are the biggest pest of them to have. This is a hive bee. Yeah, bees will have a hive bee. I don't know anybody that doesn't have a hive bee. If you get your packing bees, if you get a nuke, if you get a swarm, they'll have a hive bee. They fly with the bees. I don't know any definite way to get rid of them. There's treatments for them. We put hive bee traps in all parts, but we still have hive bees. So the gentleman I'd like to give the next big meeting, he says, yes, because hive bee is good for him. He said, to crush good hive bees. So that's what he does with his hive bee. But hive bee treatments, you have Checkmate, Guard Star, Hematodes, Diatomaceous Earth, the hybrid line, traps, and let them out of the boat. But like I told you before, they don't like the heat. So if you keep it beat out in the sunlight, it will reduce the population of the hybrids. I keep on, like I said, ours is right out in the sun all day long. I thought they needed to be in shade, and had to be in shade. We moved our bees about 3 times. Then you have mice. This was a picture of mine. What happened to my hive? The mice were in there, and they ate the honey and frames. We did put the picture on that. I didn't even think about it. But mice got into the hive, and I guess the bees were all on the top and didn't see it yet. Sometimes if the bees see it, they will kill them. So, if you have a strong knot, what do you think that means? Hope you don't have a bear in this area. That's what bears do to their hives. They elevate the hive, and some people, right here on the landing board on the hive, like he showed you the bottom board, some people put those tack strips that use for carpeting. We put a tack strip because of that. Well, it hurt the bees. These dislike quick movements about especially people whose yards are covered with lichen. Bees dislike the offensive odor of spray gallons and are not enduring pure air and bees. Honeybees ripen nectar by removing the moisture. They take all the moisture out of the honey. That's why the honey waiter is happy.
You split split it down the middle, try to equal it out as best you can. One of them will have to clean, one of them won't. So that one that don't, won't have to clean. But that two equal size hive, so you can put them side by side. Then you can do the cheap method like I did. Start robbing a couple frames of brood, a couple frames of hive of honey, and you leave a little space, and you put that in a small hook. That's a baby. What you do is you pull that roof and you try to keep those bees that's on that frame, they're new bees, and try to ease that right down the box. So there's, you can make a small split, knowing that if you've got a small split, that's a small bunch of bees. If you've got a huge hive right over here next door to it, when it gets bad times, wait till summer dark, they'll grow up. So if you make a small split like that, not a big, I move mine to another yard. Because I've learned a hard lesson. I've lost some of these good splits because late fall, big hives will run in there and drop them out. They can't defend it. But yes, you can put them side by side and get another deep split. Even if you do an equal split, if you've got one huge hive, you did the one split, then you've got the danger of a small one being locked out. You can do two things with bees. You can either make honey or you can make bees.
Elected state representative in the 43rd district of Tennessee, which covers about two-thirds of Warren County and all of Grundy and all of White County. And about a month ago, I had the opportunity to be a part of the class in White County that was teaching about the bees and the importance of it, and a good class. So they asked me if I would come down today and just be a little part of it to encourage you and let you know that from the state side, that we want to be supportive of you folks that has bees for us in our society. Well, as I didn't know this, but this lady right here, her daughter, Frances Arthur, is a very good friend of mine, and I didn't know that she was the one that was going to be teaching the class today. So what an honor to be able to do this. But I just want to say that if there's something that we can do from the state level, I want you to know, feel free to give us a call, or I'll be around if you want to talk to me about it or have an issue. And it may not be about bees or some kind of other issue that you have. I just want to let you know that I'm here supporting you and let you know that if we can do something to help you in whatever needs might be in your life. You know, I was thinking about, I was telling my wife who's coming down here that there's a quote from Albert Einstein. Some of you may know what that is. Anybody have a? He said that when the bees are gone, and that this ain't exactly how he said it, but when the bees are gone, we'll be gone. So there is a great importance for our honey bee. And my wife is a great supporter of honey because she likes honey and peanut butter for breakfast. So anyway, keep on doing these bees here so we can have honey to feed these folks out here. So I won't take any time. I know you have a meal to do, but feel free to if you have any questions and something I can do to help you in the 43rd district, feel free and ask. And I just want to say I appreciate you. Appreciate the opportunity to come and see a part of what y'all are doing to learn. Thank you. Yeah, I'll hang around if somebody has any questions. Thank you.
Let's give thanks for our food. We'll just bow our head. Our dear Heavenly Father, we're so thankful for this day and it's been blessings. We're so thankful for this food that's been prepared for us. Help it to nourish our bodies and us in thy service. Be with us as we struggle to learn these things and help us to use them that we can better the environment and help things around the country. Be with us throughout the rest of this day. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Let's see.